Okay, so there's a lot more research that's being done on this to see whether or not, you know, how much effect gut microbes have on normal mammalian brain development. But 30%, I'll show you the slide later, 30% of the metabolites in our blood come from bacteria. And that includes serotonin and other neurotransmitters made by the bacteria. So animals are not individuals by developmental criteria either. There's mutualistic, symbiotic bacteria, which are necessary for normal development, not for something special, just to make us who we think we are normally. So we're not anatomical individuals. We're not physiological individuals. We're not genetic individuals. We're not developmental individuals. Well, what about the immune system? We know that the immune system protects us against the hostile world. That you know, we are protected by our immune system. Only recent evidence has shown that our immune system's more like bouncers or passport control. They know who to let in and who to keep out. And so our immune system actually prepares Peyer's patches and other places in the intestine for microbial symbionts to dwell in. Okay. IgA reduces intestinal pro-inflammatory signaling. Wow, it reduces and bacterial epitope expression, thereby balancing suppression of the oxidative burst with the antibody's negative impact on bacterial fitness. These results underscore the adaptive immune system's critical role in establishing a sustainable host-microbial relationship. I thought they were there, you know, immune system was there to prevent a host-microbial relationship. Here it's sustaining it. Opportunistic bacteria uniquely inhabit Peyer's patches, leading to Peyer patches' DC-initiated local antigen-specific antibody production. This may involve the creation of an optimal symbiotic environment on the interior of the Peyer's patches. Toll-like receptors. Therefore, commensal bacteria exploit the toll-like receptor pathway to actively suppress immunity. Well, they're supposed to activate immunity, but it's suppressing it. We propose that the immune system can discriminate between pathogens and the microbiota through recognition of symbiotic bacterial molecules in a process that engenders commensal colonization. This is a whole new area of immunology. This is the area of microbial colonization. The notion that toll receptors, which are usually thought of as inducing the innate immune response, the toll receptors either are suppressed themselves or the toll receptors allow the entry of certain bacteria. You know, the phrase of John Donne, no man is an island. Well, that's right sociologically, but actually if you're an E. coli, if you're a Bacteroides, that's exactly what a man is. Here is this huge system, 37 degrees C, carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, just ready to be colonized. And the rules of colonization occur. Those which get in first establish the rules by which others can colonize. And this is a whole new area of bacteriology and of immunology, which is the colonization of the normal colonization of the host to make a holobiont. So we're not even immunologically individuals. Well, what about physiological, where the organism is an individual whose parts, component parts cooperate for the benefit of the whole? This is the frontispiece to Hobbes' Leviathan, you know, where all the people of the realm get together for a commonwealth. You know, Thomas Hobbes, Adam Smith, and in biology, Rudolf Lurkert and Henri Milne-Edwards were big supporters of this notion of the physiological individual commonwealth. Just as the cells coordinate together, so we find that the metabolites of symbionts and the host coordinate together. So here we have the pathway for phenylalanine in the planococcus, a bug. And here's phenylalanine, which is being produced, but actually there's planococcus. Here's Tremblia, which is a symbiont of planococcus. And here's provisionally named Morinella, a bacterium, which is a symbiont of the symbiont. And the pathway to make phenylalanine begins in the symbiont, goes into the symbiont's symbiont, back into the symbiont, then into the host to make phenylalanine. So phenylalanine is a product of three organisms. So physiologically, we have a situation here where it isn't the genome of the bug that's making phenylalanine, it's the genome of the bug, the genome of the bug's bug, the genome of the bug's bug bug. Okay? As much as one-third of an animal's metabolome, the diversity of molecules carried in its blood, has a microbial origin. Thus, the circulatory system extends the chemical impact of the microbiota throughout the body. I recommend this paper, the McFaul and Guy paper, in PNAS very highly. It really is extending Lynn Margulis's work enormously, showing that the world is really a bacterial world. We're just passengers. Here we have some of the metabolites in our blood. You know, short-chain fatty acids, especially butyrate, bile acids, choline, of course, the vitamins. These are all things that are produced by bacteria. What's in red are things which have been known to cause epigenetic changes. This picture, which is from the McFaul and Guy paper, look at the microbiota as kind of central, and it's supporting the digestive system, it's supporting the circulatory system, the immune system, reciprocally. There are reciprocal relationships. It's normative physiology. The microbiota are part of our physiology. Interactions between diet and microbes. First, indole metabolism. Tryptophan gets metabolized to indole in the gut bacteria. It can be made into IPA, going directly into the blood, or it can be made into indoxal, which is actually poisonous. It's a nephrotoxin. Over here we have graphs, conventionally raised and germ-free raised mice. See, germ-free raised mice have very little serotonin. We have serotonin in our blood, and it's not from our bodies, it's from the bacterial bodies. Okay, over here, indole-3 propionic acid, which actually gives us protection against free radical oxygens. Germ-free mice don't have it. The mice with the bacteria have it. Similarly, tryptophan. Tryptophan is metabolized. We have less tryptophan in the conventionally raised mice than in germ-free mice. So there's an intimate connection between the symbiont and the host. It's one big physiological system. And if there was any need to give further proof to it, this paper in Science about kwashiorkor that came out earlier this year. Co-metabolism, this is their term. This is the term of Smith et al. In Jeffrey Gordon's lab. Microbe-host co-metabolism as a function of microbiota and host diet. They looked at identical twins in Malawi who were discordant for the disease kwashiorkor. Kwashiorkor has been known as a protein deficiency disease. Causes edemic swelling, causes anorexia, causes a loss of appetite, and which further enhances the protein deficiency. It's a horrible, lethal disease. What they were able to do is they were able to take the feces from identical twins discordant for kwashiorkor, put them into germ-free mice, and then give the germ-free mice a protein-deficient diet. Only those mice who had the bacteria from the kwashiorkor children developed kwashiorkor. The bacteria were in large part responsible for causing kwashiorkor. You need the protein deficiency, but you need certain bacteria as well. And what was interesting is you could change the bacteria content by just giving them basically peanut butter, this peanut-based, ready-to-use therapeutic food. Basically changed the bacterial population. It gave bacteria different things to eat. And so what was eliminated were the bad guys, including Clostridium. What was brought in was Bifidobacteria, Lactobacillus, and a host of good guys. Very simple therapy. And so here we have this notion of co-metabolism. Another example of interactions between diet and microbe, obesity, probably seen this study before. This is a leptin deficient, an obese mouse, and it certainly is. This is its litter mate, which is a lean heterozygous mouse. And what happens is there are different bacteria in here. There are different, there's Firmicutes versus Bacteroidetes. And you see the Firmicutes in the obese mouse have increased at the expense of the Bacteroidetes. If you have germ-free mice and you put the bacteria into it from either obese mice or wild-type mice, you get a different result. Those who got the bacteria from the obese mouse increased their weight faster than the mice with the, who got their bacteria from the wild-type mice. So here we have a basically a bacterial transplant, and the bacteria are giving the induced obese response. So you start off here, it's very interesting, you start off with a genetic disease, different bacteria are seem to be selected, and these bacteria basically can transfer that condition, the obese condition, from mouse to mouse. Pregnancy. This is humans now. Women's physiology get altered by the gut microbiome during the third trimester. Again, using these mice, if you take the gut bacteria of pregnant women during their first trimester, give them to the bacteria to germ-free mice, you basically keep a normal mouse phenotype. If you take bacteria from pregnant women at third trimester and you transplant them into germ-free mice, what you find is that there's greater cytokine, inflammatory cytokine production. They get different, these are different types of bacteria, and the third trimester microbes induce pregnancy-like metabolism, including a metabolic syndrome, into the mice. They have insulin desensitization. They get fatter with a bacterial transplant. Okay, so when we talk about humans and other mammals as being in an aseptic environment and that we don't have bacterial, you know, we don't have to concern ourselves with bacteria, that's actually not the case, because the fetus is getting metabolites from the mother's bacteria. Bacteria will modify the mother's dietary compounds, the bacteria will modify the mother's physiology, and it may be important to control for bacterial populations when analyzing fetal or maternal metabolism. Now, I mentioned before that birth is going from one symbiotic environment to another. And what prepares this, really interestingly, is the opening of the amnion, so that the fetus is now exposed to the bacteria of the reproductive tract, and also mother's milk. Human milk oligosaccharides cannot be digested. There are some oligosaccharides in mother's milk that can't be digested by human infants. They are food not for the infants, they're food for the bacteria such as bifidobacteria, which we want in the gut of our infants. So we have natural prebiotics. The milk is not only giving nutrition, it's not only given immune supplements, it's also given bacterial growth factors so that the bacteria that we want will grow. So we are not physiological individuals either. Well then, what about evolution? This is a quote from Lynn Margulis. In short, I believe that most evolutionary novelty arose and still arises directly from symbiosis, and life did not take over the globe by combat, but by networking. So I just want to go over some of these recent developments. I mentioned before that genetic variation can take place through symbionts. Remember the pea aphid story. But I want to talk just very briefly about reproductive isolation through symbionts. Symbionts which can selective give you different mating preferences, and symbionts which can actually split a species possibly into two. Again, I mentioned the endosymbionts giving variations such as Rickettsiella, Hamiltonella, Bucknera in the aphid, that their alleles give properties to the holobiont. Symbiotic bacteria may be responsible for mating preferences in Drosophila. This has been known anecdotally for years, that Drosophila liked to mate with those who ate the same food that they did as larvae. So when antibiotics get rid of the bacteria, matings become random, not assortative. Lacto, this is between molasses versus starch. Those bacteria that, those Drosophila that had their larval eating on molasses, like other Drosophila that ate molasses, those who had starch like starch. Okay, it seems that Lactobacillus plantarum is the critical thing. If you take formerly germ-free flies and you infect them with Lactoplantarum, they'll mate with each other. Lactobacillus plantarum is primarily a starch. It's found on starch, not in molasses. And if you get rid of the bacteria, you get rid of mating preferences. Differences are abrogated when bacteria are removed. It seems that the bacteria are helping control the formation of contact pheromones that are used during reproduction. Cytoplasmic incompatibility to Wolbachia. This is, again, Nesonia, a parasitoid wasp. And Bordenstein and colleagues are finding that there's actually different strains of Wolbachia. And these different strains of Wolbachia can give cytoplasmic incompatibility such that you cannot get these strains together in the same population once they have separated. Now, I just want to say that, you know, this evolutionarily means something very different. We're not now talking about evolution of individuals. We're talking about evolution of holobionts. This is from the aphids. In our system, the evolutionary interests of phages, bacterial symbionts, and aphids are all aligned against the parasitoid wasp that threatens them all. The phage is implicated in conferring protection to the aphid and thus contributes to the spread and maintenance of the bacteria, H. defensa, in natural aphid populations. Okay, but it's not group selection, because group selection involves individuals of the same species. This is really team selection. Okay, I'm a Packers fan. Okay. We are teams. We're selected as teams. When you think of teams, it's the team that goes on to the playoff, not the individual who's the leading pass receiver. Doesn't matter if you're the leading pass receiver, if you're on a team that doesn't win the game. And so all the things that we talk about teams is what we're talking about with the holobiont. Communication within group, collections of individuals for common goal, group identification, division of labor based on morphology, physiology, and although there may be a script, improvisation is critical for both the parts and whole. There's both individual and group selection. Usually, excellence of a part is good for the whole, but while each part wants to get into the record book, it's the team that wins or loses. So we are teams. We get selected as teams. And the last thing I want to say is, we probably never were individuals. This is research from Nicole King's lab that metazoans, you know, multicellular organisms, multicellular animals, may have originated in a symbiosis between coanoflagellate protists and their bacteria. This is a free-living coanoflagellate, and it divides to make other free-living coanoflagellates, but if it's cultured with algorophagous bacteria, which is usually found in its environment, it develops into a multicellular organism with an extracellular matrix and with bridges between each of its cells. And so we have here a model for the formation of a multicellular organism, and it's based on some sort of symbiosis with bacteria. So, biological individualities for animals, not. 9 out of every 10 of our cells is microbes. We are joined in common metabolic pathways to a common purpose, the common defense, that we are not physiological individuals, we are holobionts, we are physiologically integrated with our symbionts. We are not even developmentally individual. Our gut microbes help build our gut, our immune system. In the squid, the light organ, they prevent ovarian cell death in Nesonia, and lots of other things. It seems that this is the rule, that we are not developmentally individual. Microbes help build the immune system. They expand the lymphocyte repertoire. The microbes are allowed to become self. Our immune system is more like bouncers or passport control than they are an army. We're not individuals by the immune criteria. Genetically, our genome is evolved with those of our symbionts. We have over 100 different genomes in our bodies. Many give different phenotypic outcomes. And symbionts can provide selectable variation. They could provide genetic isolation. We seem to be evolutionarily holobionts as well. So where to go from here? It's really interesting. If microbes have paracrine and endocrine effects on gene expression, what constitutes the epigenetics of symbiosis? I really don't know. There are only like two papers that I could find on, you know, chromatin changes by microbes. And this is something that Eva Jablanka, here shown with Lynn Margulis in 2009 in Boston, this is a whole new area to study. Hardly anybody is doing work in what is the epigenetics of symbiosis. And the bottom line is, we are all lichens. What had been peripheral is normative. And here are three papers in case you want to look up something more about this. This is a friend of mine's daughter amongst the lichens. Thank you very much. Okay. I'll take some questions first.
So I can accept and embrace everything that you've said. From an ontological perspective, though, I would argue that just as the historical individuality of a lineage is not negated by the loss or the acquisition of character states over time, that the historical individuality of an organism is not negated by the loss of parts, the acquisition of infection, the loss of a limb, the regeneration of a limb. And I'm wondering if you ever discuss these things with philosophers and what they say about it.
Yeah, yeah. I've had wonderful talks with people like Donna Haraway about this. And Dick Burian. And it's interesting because this is a whole notion of biological selfhood as opposed to selfhood in other parts of our lives, social selfhood, for instance. And we get into interesting discussions about, what we're really talking about here in the big context is a kind of genetic selfhood, that we are, a unigenomic individual. And you have many different types of selves as well. There's the genomic self, I have my genome. There's the mental self, if I were to put my brain into you, you'd be me. And there's the immune self, if I were to put, And so even the way biological selfhood is defined is really different. The notion of lineages is fascinating because what I think that we're doing here is making a multi-lineage individual. That, yes, I have my historical lineage and, my grandparents came from Russia, et cetera, going all the way back. But there's also a lineage of microbes which goes back even longer. And that is being integrated. And it's fluid. It's a porous boundary because it's not even more so than with the arthropods. I'm getting my symbionts by infection, which means I can share them. So it's not so much that I have a constituent lineage. It's not so much that I have an essence, so to speak, I guess, a core, but that I am being able to, especially if what I'm talking about, the brain is correct, I'm now having my lineage integrated intimately with those of other lineages. And what Eva Jablanka talks about, epigenetic as a deep, intimate dialogue between host and symbionts. What I'm finding is, I'm now in dialogue with things that I'm allowing to become self. I'm having these discussions and they're a lot of fun and very influential. Yes?
One thing, this is really cool. One thing that should not be overlooked is the persistence of conflict between elements of the composite individual. For instance, internally transmitted endosymbionts in insects often involve male killing.
Yep.
They kill their male members. So that part of the picture is not
Yeah. And one of the things that, again, we find interesting here is, and again, Darwin was talking about this, and he goes back to Leibniz, is the notion of compossibility, that lots of things are possible but not compossible, not possible together. And even in mammals, you have this amazing thing of mitochondrial killing. I don't know where if that the sperm mitochondria are actively killed. That they're first of all not very good when they get there anyway, but you know they're kind of expended, but they are actively killed not only by dilution of a dividing cell, but there are agents which go in and destroy the paternal mitochondria so that there's only one mitochondrial lineage, you know, per zygote. So yeah, there are all sorts of. I'm not saying there's no competition. I believe, you know, one of the things that Lynn Margulis said, Gaia is a real bitch. Yeah, there's competition and cooperation together. And what I want to say here, though, is that, you know, I think for a lot of evolution and a lot of development, we've been kind of ignoring this cooperation. We've been thinking in a very us versus them. And the them is kind of part of us as well now. And so I want to kind of, but yeah, there's certainly competition within the holobiont in that respect. Yes.
So it seems like taking all this together, that we're really talking about a theory of community ecology that applies to the whole ecosystem of ourselves, and also an idea of some sense of a metapopulation biology, mm-hmm. the extinction of populations and colonization of extinct yeah. ones, only not so much at the population level, but at the community level, so the community's agreements. Has anybody gone after this idea of applying community ecology principles to this whole biome?
I think that Sarkis Masmanian at Caltech is looking at this. He's looking at it medically, but he's looking at it as a colonization, kind of island colonization dynamics. Who colonizes when? What are the rules for colonization? You know, based on temporal, you know, those who get there first. How do you resource partition out this huge environment that you're in? And that's actually, there was a new paper by him which looked at Bacteroides, and Bacteroides actively colonizing a particular niche within the intestine and having a gene which basically says, we are here, all the rest of you Bacteroides, you know, get pooped out. We've filled the niches. And, you know, basically saying, you know, enough, you know, don't even try. Don't even try to get through the mucus. We're here. And so there's, I think that they're just starting, people are just starting to look at the population dynamics of this holobiont that we are. The interesting, different metaphors are coming up. Like I started off with the metaphor of, you know, that we can look at the microbes as like any other cell in the developing organism. It's producing paracrine factors, it's producing some things which look like endocrine factors, that we have to view them as a part of, you know, like the zygote, like just, you know, a normal part of a normal cell in our body. You know, they're inducing gene expression in neighboring cells. But another model now is, you know, populations and metapopulations, since the population on our hands differ, population in our throats differ. We are a collection of ecosystems, and how that resource partitioning takes place is something that people are just beginning to start looking at. Yeah. Yes.
So, I mean, there's something scary about what you've shown in the fact for embryologists. Mm-hmm. The fact that, you know, or system have been so simplified. We take the animal, and if there is any algae growing in a tank, we get sued. And if, you know,
yes.
if there is fly growing,
yes.
and we have to put antibiotics in all our media.
Mm-hmm.
And are we selecting, or are we completely changing the development to something completely artificial that has nothing to do with what would actually happen?
This one of the two, the paper by Hooper et al., which I mentioned before, with the gene expression, was one of the papers that got me involved in this. The other paper was by David Eppel called Beakers and Breakers, which was about sea urchin fertilization, which says, you know, we do in the laboratory, when we teach our students sea urchin fertilization, we get close to 100% fertilization. That doesn't happen in nature. In nature, the sea urchin is in a pond where there's UV light on it. If we were to expose ourselves to that UV light, we'd be fried. Our DNA would be toasted. What does this mean about the sea urchin egg? Well, what it means is it has sun filters. You know, it has natural sun filters. Nobody knew about this until we started looking at the environment. I think we are changing the environment when we do our developmental biology. One of the people who is involved in this is a person at Pitt.
Relier.
Who was able to show that when you add a particular pesticides to tadpoles in an aquarium, nothing happens to tadpoles. They're fine. But when you add the same amount of pesticide to tadpoles that are in a makeshift pond, which includes predators and includes conspecifics, the same amount of pesticide wipes out the tadpoles. And that's because the tadpoles are being changed by the predator. They have some plasticity. They're being changed by the predator. Their liver metabolizes this pesticide in a different way. I think that we are looking at a very artificial population of animals when we look at them in the laboratory, and we try to control everything. I think that one of the principles of the EcoDevo book that I wrote was there actually is a whole world out there to study. We've taken seven organisms, and we've taken these seven organisms and given them very sterile diets, very sterile environments, and so forth. And I do wonder if what we're doing is predisposing us to see certain things and not others. And a whole range, well, certainly the whole plasticity of phenotypes we're not seeing because we don't give them that opportunity. Yeah. Yeah, but the Iacocca rules are kind of interesting, huh? Yes.
Well, so extending that same idea to us.
Yeah.
We should stop using antibacterial wipes and start rubbing elbows as much as we can, right? So we're not selecting our cells as islands. We want a mixture as much as possible, right?
Of course, there are bad guys out there. You know, there are real bad guys out there. But the thing is that, you probably are aware of the hygiene hypothesis, which says we have eliminated a lot of the bacteria we want from our system, and that if you want to look at things like the increase in asthma, increase in colitis, it might be because we have gotten rid of the bacteria that normally we've evolved with to protect us against certain things. And there's a lot of research on hygiene hypothesis and the notion that we are too sterile for our own good, that in getting rid of the bad guys, I had abdominal surgery, so I know there are bad guys. In getting rid of these bad guys, we've also gotten rid of some things which are really essential for our health. One thing which is really interesting, when I mentioned before the research on the Peyer's patches, where there are microbes in the Peyer's patches, these microbes, which go really deep into our intestine, are probably refractile to microbiotics. The microbiotics can't get there. There's a mucus membrane between them. So this might be the reservoir from which, you know, when we use antibiotics, the normal bacteria come up. It's also been suggested that our appendix, which has a valve-like structure on it, might be a reservoir for bacteria. And of course, the most important, pediatric cause of death is, diarrhea and, dehydration. And this might be where the good bacteria come back after bouts of severe diarrhea. So, again, I think it's changing the way we look at, our anatomy and our physiology, as well as kind of who we are as individuals. Okay.
This on at the Faculty Club one more time.
Thank you.